Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode one of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This one's going to be fun. This one's going to be real fun because this entire episode is going to be a retrospective of my experience getting a bachelor's degree in internet marketing from Full Sail University. I'm going to address the school of thought that says just Google it and doesn't necessarily agree with the concept of going to college to get a degree in internet marketing. So, just as a point of differentiation, again, unlike 99.9% of the players in this space, I have a degree in digital marketing. I am not one of these self-proclaimed internet marketing ninjas slash gurus slash mavens, right? I didn't just wake up one day and decided to give it a go. I'm not a mommy blogger. No diss to the mommy bloggers and all the self-taught individuals out there. I think if you were able to strike off on your own and figure out digital marketing at a high level and how to make a living out of it without having to borrow $57,000 from the U.S. Department of Education, that is awesome and amazing. I am openly envious of you. However, that was not my experience. I had to go to college to really get good at it. And in my experience, just from talking to other people and small business owners at conferences, most of them can't figure it out on their own either. So hats off to you. I think that's really amazing. But, you know, that's not me, and I'm talking to the majority of folks who might be considering going to college for digital marketing or just need a different side of the equation, because I don't feel that those of us with formal education have done a very good job of speaking up and speaking out when prominent people like your Gary Vaynerchuk's and whatnot come out and say, don't go to college. I think people need to hear a different point of view from someone who has actually gone through the process. And just so that I'm clear, when it comes to structured education and internet marketing, I am biased, but I am not bougie. I do not think that everybody needs a degree. I don't think everyone has to follow the same path as I have. But again, there's a lot of noise, there's a lot of chatter in the digital marketing space, and I don't think that it's objective enough. And I think that those of us with a different experience need to step forth and sort of add a little bit to the conversation. So first things first, most people who are going to tell you not to go to college for digital marketing or have an issue with it are going to fall into one of three buckets. They either don't have a degree at all, so they're just anti-structured education in general, or they have a degree that has absolutely nothing to do with digital marketing. Their degrees are in journalism or computer science or something like that. It's secondary or tertiary related to internet marketing, but not really. Or they just have a general marketing degree or an MBA and they took a class in social media, or they had digital marketing as an elective. Whereas I, on the other hand, front to back, beginning to end, my entire degree, my elected major is in digital marketing. So I'm part of a very small minority. There are less than 1,000 of us with this degree. So it's growing, it's getting more popular, but by no means is it commonplace as of yet. So shortly after graduation, I wrote a blog post that you can find on my LinkedIn profile. It's called Five Reasons Your Five Reasons May Suck. And it was in response to a blog post I saw on their Surviving After College blog that said five reasons you may not need a degree in internet marketing. And we'll get to that in the second half of the show. But before we do that, we need to address this whole school of thought that just says Google it, because there are several things that's wrong with this school of thought, and not a lot of people just take the time to really think it through. So we're going to start there, and then in the second half of the program, we're going to go point by point of these 5 points that this person on the Surviving After College blog brought up as to why you don't want to get a degree in internet marketing. So, a couple things you need to know if you're in the school of thought that says just Google it, and that is Web 2.0 and the paradox of choice. Again, Web 2.0 and the paradox of choice. So the way the web used to work back in the day is that when you went to Google and you typed in your search query, Google will return the results based on the formula in its algorithm, and it wouldn't really consider external factors, right? This led to the unfortunate practice of keyword stuffing, where you're basically just cramming in as much keywords as possible to try to artificially influence your organic ranking in the search engine, and some other black hat tactics. Black hat, for those who may be unfamiliar with the term, is any sort of trick or tactic where you're basically trying to game the system. And you're living very dangerously as a black hat, because that stuff works until it doesn't. So the way the web works now with what's called Web 2.0 is that when you go to Google and you type in your search query, Google is going to return the results they have on it, and they're going to combine it with the information that they have of you as an individual. So what you watch on YouTube, your browsing history, who you're connected to in your social graph, the types of thing you buy online, they're going to combine all of that along with the search query and return a first page that is unique to you. So my first page results won't be the exact same as your first page results for the exact same search term, because our browsing behavior and who we're connected to in our social graph is different. And yes, I know there are privacy concerns because people get all big brother on you, but there's actually a really good non-insidious reason that Google does this, and that is context. So as human beings, our brains build context automatically. We just automatically make connections and we know what we're talking about. However, that's a fairly tall order for a non-sentient machine. You don't believe me? I'll prove it to you. Let's do a quick word association. If I say the word apple, am I talking about a delicious fruit that comes in red, green, and sometimes yellow varieties? Am I talking about a consumer electronics company that makes all of the products that we can't live without? Or am I talking about the record labels that the Beatles founded, right? So one word, several different contexts depending on what you're looking for. And in order for Google to be able to figure that out, they need to know a little bit about you. So that's the first chink in the armor of the just Google it school of thought. It assumes that you're going to find the same thing as everybody else, and that may or may not be the case depending on several factors. So my number one result might be your number four result, and your number six result may not make it on my first page at all. The second problem with the just Google it school of thought is it called the paradox of choice. And the paradox of choice basically says that the more options that you have, the more difficult it becomes to actually make a decision. The more options that you have, the more difficult it becomes to make a decision. And so there's this weird social phenomena that comes along with Google. Because there is so much data available, people feel like they should have perfect information. Like there's never any excuse not to know anything, because you could have just gone to Google and figured it out. But it just takes so long to wade through all of the BS, because as we all know, everything you find online isn't true. A lot of it is not true. And so because it takes so long to decipher the real for the fake, people look for clues and shortcuts in the form of ratings and reviews. The problem with that is that a lot of that stuff can be faked. So take me, for example. I wrote a book along with a fellow Full Sail grad called Beyond Buzzwords, Social Media, Mobile, and Other Marketing Buzzwords Ain't the Half of It. If you haven't already, please do check that out at thinkbeyondbuzzwords.com. And we are dying for reviews. I'm talking, we are hurting bad for it. And if you're listening to this right now, if you bought the book or you're going to buy the book, please, please, please leave a review on Amazon. Now, if I was less than ethical and so inclined to, I could go to a website called Fiverr.com, F-I-V-E-R-R.com, and I could pay someone to review my book. They could even do a video review. I could mail them a book. They could hold the book up, say, hey, this book is great. It's awesome. It's amazing. You should buy it. And I could get my reviews that way, $5 at a time. But as an ethical professional, I don't do such things because, you know, this journey that I've been on, I've been doing this since 2003, 2004, and it took an additional year to write the book. So when you get that book, you're literally holding like 12 years of my life, and I want to know what you think. Right? And that's a little on the melodramatic side, I'll admit. But the point is that it's especially easy to polish a turd online, and a lot of people just don't have the skill set to separate the real from the fake. There's a really good book on it called Manipurated that you should check out. It's Manipulated plus Rating, so Manipurated. Check out that book, and it goes into detail about how you can basically game the system. And so I say all of that to say this: the Just Google It school of thought assumes that people can call BS when they see it online. And in my experience, most people just can't. That's simply not the case. In addition to this, being self-taught is an inherently reactive process, meaning that I need to know how to do this, and so I'll go off and I'll learn this. Or I need to be able to do that, and so I go off and I learn that. And just due to that, it's very heavy on tactics and can be light on strategy. And you might be hip deep in something before you figure out that you need to pivot. And so those are just the base issues with the school of thought that says just Google it. It does not take into account Web 2.0. Or the paradox of choice, and it assumes that people can call BS when they see it, and a lot of folks just can't. We're going to take a short break, and when we get back, we're going to address point by point reasons people think you don't need a degree in digital marketing from the Surviving After College blog. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry. This is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately, most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. Welcome back. So on my LinkedIn profile, I wrote a blog post called Five Reasons Your Five Reasons May Suck. And this was in response to a blog post I found on survivingaftercollege.com that listed out five reasons why you shouldn't go to college for a degree in internet marketing. And they are: the industry changes too fast, the jobs don't require a degree, those years could have been spent gaining experience instead of studying, you're overpaying, and you can easily create your own online business. Now, again, I have to reiterate that when it comes to structured education, I am biased, but I am not bougie. I am not here to try to convince anyone that they should or shouldn't go to college. I just want to give a different opinion because, again, you have a lot of these blog posts out there and you got a lot of prominent people spouting off about things that technically they're uneducated about because they've never been through the process, whereas I, on the other hand, I have. Okay, so if I were to grade this, I would give this a triple D, and that is dangerous, dated, and does more harm than good. So first point: the industry changes too fast to be taught in college. You're making several assumptions there. The first being that the instructors teach from the halls of academia and aren't actively involved in the industry. And that's not true at all. Most, if not all, of the professors have their own digital marketing agencies where they actively service clients. An awesome podcast that I listen to, that I recommend you listen to, is the Marketing Smarts podcast by Marketing Profs. It's hosted by former Full Sail University professor Kerry O'Shea Gorgon, and she had James Loomstein on there. He was an adjunct professor at the Southern Methodist University Cox School of Business, and he's also the managing partner at Rogue Marketing. And I'm tells you, this guy put on a master's class during that interview. You should really check it out. I'll make sure to link that up in the show notes. And he's a perfect example of why you shouldn't assume that just because it's in college means you're getting stale information, because I tells you, that James Loomstein, he put it down. Secondly, you're assuming that the course curriculum is static and not dynamic. So I started attending Full Sail University in 2012, and I graduated in 2015. If you look at my transcripts and compare it to what's up on the curriculum now, it's a very different program. I mean, the core stuff is still there. You still have, you know, email marketing, SEO, SEM, you know, funnel optimization, all that good stuff. But in terms of just a lot of different stuff, it's a very different course. So don't assume that just because it's in college, that means that the curriculum is set in stone, because it's not. It's not like, you know, finance or something like that, because in finance, a lot of the finance teachers have never run a business. So they're teaching you mathematic principles that they have never actually used because they don't run businesses. And, you know, math is kind of math. Math sort of is what it is. Whereas digital marketing, on the other hand, the course curriculum is not static. It does change to keep up with the industry. Number two, most jobs in the industry don't actually require a degree. Now, this is not incorrect, but it is incomplete. So I graduated from the degree program in March 2015, and in May, I started at Cox Media Group here in Atlanta, and I was an SEM manager. So Cox Media Group, they're a media conglomerate, and they own television stations and newspapers. So the same small business owners that would advertise on the evening news or in the newspaper, your lawyers, your plumbers, your doctor, they would take that ad spend and put it on Google. And to get that job, you had to be AdWords certified. You actually had to have all of the certifications, not just the fundamentals and the advanced search, but you also needed to have the mobile, video, shopping, etc. And, you know, that didn't require a degree. I was one of two people who had degrees, because there was another Full Sailor who worked there. And all you needed was your certifications. However, assuming that you don't need a degree to work in this industry ignores some very powerful megatrends that are acting on the industry. For example, I watched this makeup show on Sci-Fi called Face Off, and they just do like movie makeup and fantasy makeup that you would see on, you know, Star Trek or something like that. So they give the Twitter handle of everybody on the show, and during commercial breaks, they want you to tweet for a chance to win $10,000. Now, using Twitter to run a competition is fairly old hat as of, you know, 2016 as I'm recording this, but that was unheard of 5 years ago. Like, nobody was doing that. And that combines both Twitter and mobile, because most people use Twitter on their mobile devices. So yes, it is correct that a lot of times the folks that you're going to find in these positions don't have any formal training. But as the industry progresses and businesses get more serious about digital marketing, they are looking for specialized skills. I mean, because let's be frank, back in the day when this first started, a lot of businesses were just waiting for this whole social media thing to blow over. They did not take it seriously. And here we are 10, 15 years later, and folks are just now getting serious about it in terms of business. And then, you know, back in the day, most people who were just a little bit technical savvy, they got deemed a quote unquote tech person because, you know, they knew how to open their email. And then all of the other stuff that came down the pipe sort of fell in their lap. But again, going forward, that is not the case. So, number three, you could have used that time gaining experience in the field instead of going to school. So, remember what I talked about in the first half of this podcast about people's BS meters being off, right? So, if you just Google something, there's a lot of bad information out there and you might find yourself taken advantage of and not even know it. So, in the degree program, one of the folks that I was studying with, he was an affiliate for electronic cigarettes. And the cigarette company brought in this superstar guru that taught the affiliates a bunch of black hat SEO tactics. And my friend, doing as he was instructed, actually got to the first page of Google. And then Google's Penguin update came along and he was de-indexed. Now, here's the rub. He did not know that he was doing anything wrong. He was just doing what the guru said to do. And so if you're not careful, you can find yourself on Warrior Forum or some other seedy part of the web getting information that you don't recognize as black hat or whatever, and that can get you in a lot of trouble. Quick story. I was 4, maybe 5 months into the degree program, and I had to take an English class. And the English teacher asked us to list the top people in our field. And first name out of my mouth was Frank Kern. Up until that point, I thought he was like the internet marketer of all internet marketers. And so I listed out Frank Kern, Mike Filsaime, Ryan Dice, Yannick Silver, Evan Pagan, right? A lot of the folks that you'd find on Warrior Forum back in the day. And she kind of gently had to let me down, and she shared with me this article on The Verge that had an attached YouTube video to it, basically, you know, ripping all of that apart. And I'll make sure I'll link that up in the show notes. And even after that, I wasn't convinced. I was like, no, that was biased. Frank Kern is awesome. These people don't know what they're talking about. They're jealous of his success. They're a bunch of haters. Frank Kern is like the dude. And so she was like, dude, if you look at the industry level digital marketer, some of the conferences that we're exposing you to, you are never going to see Frank Kern on one of those stages. You're never going to see Frank Kern at like a Salesforce Dreamforce or MozCon or something like that. He's just not going to be there. Now, do you think that's because these people don't know about him? No, it's because he can't survive the vetting process. And it was then that I really appreciated that there were kind of levels to digital marketing. You have your corporate digital marketers, you have your info marketers, and there's just levels to the stuff that prior to I was not, you know, I really didn't appreciate, because all I knew was Warrior Forum and info marketing products. And as a result, I picked up a lot of bad habits that I didn't know that I had. Like that whole Fiverr thing I told you about, how to buy reviews. Guess where I learned that from? Warrior Forum. Right? So Full Sail is going to keep you out of trouble, and it's going to steer you away from some of the more sketchier parts of the web. Because again, when I was learning all of this stuff, I did not actively appreciate it as black hat or whatever. I just thought I was learning the game from somebody who knew the game. And so now my top five list looks completely different. If you were to ask me now, okay, who are the top people in the industry? I would say Jay Baer, David Meerman Scott, Ann Hanley, who else? I would say Mike King, Rand Fishkin. I mean, the list goes on and on. But again, totally different atmosphere, totally different set of circumstances that, again, if you're just Googling and you just teach yourself, you're not necessarily going to appreciate. And so, number four, you're overpaying. All right, let's have a little conversation about access to capital, shall we? Because yes, there is a lot of good information that you can get out there that in aggregate is less than getting a bachelor's degree. However, you gotta have the money up front. So there's a whole lot of conferences out there. Let's take funnel hacking, for example. So Russell Brunson from ClickFunnels has this conference called Funnel Hacking, where you reverse engineer funnels. And in Full Sail, we just call that your final project. Right. Spoiler alert. If you know how to funnel hack, that's more or less your final project in Full Sail. There's going to be a little bit more to it than that because it's a group project, blah, blah, blah. But the final and funnel hacking is, you know, it's in the same breath. Now, Funnel Hacking Live, which in 2017 is going to be in Dallas, Texas, is $700. And that does not include your flight. That does not include your hotel. That does not include eating out for a full weekend. No, just to have your face in that place, $700. Once you add all that other stuff back in, you're probably looking at about $2,000 to drop at a single weekend. And that's not even in like expensive conference. If you take MozCon, formerly SEO Moz in Seattle, $1,500. And again, doesn't include flight, doesn't include hotel, doesn't include Uber back and forth or food. Once you add all that back in, you're probably looking at $3,000-$4,000 to go to MozCon. And a lot of times at these live events, you'll have the opportunity to join a VIP coaching program, which in my experience ranges anywhere from about $10,000 all the way up to $50,000, depending on what you want to do. Like if you're in the real estate and you want to be personally coached by Robert Kiyosaki, that's going to set you back $50,000-$60,000. And so you drop $3,000 on the conference, and let's say just keep the numbers round, you drop another $12,000 on the VIP coaching program, that's $15,000 to learn digital marketing from ClickFunnels. And yes, in aggregate, 15 is a lot less than 57 for a degree, but you gotta have the money up front. Russell Brunson is not going to accept financial aid. I'm sure he would if he could, but that's not how it's set up. So if you look at the composition of these things in terms of the audiences, they tend to be lily white. And by that, I mean 85%, 90% of the audience is going to be white because that's who has the disposable income. And don't worry, I'm not going to go all Noam Chomsky, Elizabeth Warren on you. But suffice it to say that there is a wealth gap in the United States, and that does inform the types of training and education that you have access to, especially if you're someone like me, lower middle class from the inner city. John Lee Dumas of Entrepreneur on Fire, awesome, amazing podcast. I highly recommend you listen to it if you don't already. Free podcast course is awesome, by the way. I took that course while I'm doing this right now. I'd have paid for that thing. It was amazing. Anyway, he talks about his journey getting to where he is today. And he got a mentor, Jamie Tardy. He was paying this woman $2,000 a month. There'd have been absolutely no way I could have swung that. And no, not because I'm not willing to invest in myself. You don't borrow $57,000 from the U.S. Department of Education being unwilling to invest in yourself. And no, not because I'm not coachable, because I actually finished the program, which means I'm teachable and I'm coachable and I got my assignments done on time. Because there's a lot of people who went to college and didn't graduate. It was too busy getting drunk and or pregnant and they never finished. Whereas I, on the other hand, I was took everything my instructor said in, I executed. So it's not that I wasn't willing to invest in myself. It's not that I wasn't willing to be coachable, but there's just no way that I could have swung that high threshold. And they price them high like that on purpose to keep the riffraff out. The problem with that is that that riffraff disproportionately tends to be people like me. It's like, you know, when you go fishing with dragnet fishing for tuna or something like that, and you accidentally snap up a sea turtle, right? You didn't mean to catch the sea turtle, just got caught in the net. And you know, that's kind of that. So yeah, if you got a spare $15,000-$20,000 on a credit card, you probably do better getting private VIP coaching from somebody like a Lewis Howe or John Lee Dumas or somebody like that. But if you don't, the fact that 15 is less than 57 isn't of much utility because you don't have access to the 15. And this is a huge gap in the digital marketing education space, and it needs to be addressed. I know that might have gotten a little bit uncomfortable for some of you, and that wasn't the intent, but this needs to be talked about, because the first step in solving a problem is admitting that there is one. And you have these expensive conferences, these very expensive training programs, and then the even more expensive degree program, and there's not a lot of middle ground. Last but not least, it's easy to create your own online business. And yeah, it is. Problem is, not everybody wants that. Because let's be frank, entrepreneurship in general and digital entrepreneurship in particular gets overly glamorized, kind of like marriage. Yes, it can be a beautiful thing, but you can also crash and burn. Don't believe me? Ask somebody who's been divorced or had a failed business. So a lot of people like myself, we weren't necessarily looking for digital entrepreneurship. We just wanted to work from home. In my own case, I was looking to avoid traditional corporate life and in particular name discrimination. I didn't necessarily want to be my own boss. Yeah, I found myself to that, but keeping it 100, if I could find a legit opportunity where I'm getting paid for my expertise and I still get to travel and speak professionally, like somebody like a Tom Webster, who's a VP for Edison, or Jason Falls, who's a VP for Elasticity, I would absolutely hop on that. The folks I just mentioned are respected thought leaders, top of their craft, and they are employees. So yes, it's easy to create your own online business, but entrepreneurship is not right for everybody. Everybody doesn't want that, and we shouldn't force it down people's throats. And so there you have it, point by point rebuttals for some of the common reasons why people think you don't need to invest in a bachelor's degree. And I hope this sheds some light on the situation from someone who's actually been through the process. Sure, there are some valid points, but there's a lot to it that frankly just doesn't get discussed. And I hope this short podcast helps shed some light on it from a different point of view. Have you ever been paralyzed while doing research? You go to Google, you type in your search query, and seconds later you're hit with millions, if not billions, of search results, and you can't make heads or tails out of any of them. Overwhelmed and afraid you'll make the wrong choice, you don't make any choice at all. Well, friends, you're not alone, but you needn't suffer in silence. The ability to make sense out of what you find online, and more importantly, call BS when you see it, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as what I've learned getting a degree in internet marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. One more time, bit.ly.com/DMD course. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.